welcome to this worship service in the name of Jesus Christ. I'm Amelia Stinson Wesley, the senior pastor of Memorial United Methodist Church here in Charlotte, North Carolina. And on behalf of our staff and our regularly worshiping congregation, I welcome you to this worship experience. Whether you are a member of our church or have found us online, I am just delighted that you have joined us today. Like many of you, I have watched the events in our nation's capital with great dismay and growing concern. While not surprised by what has happened after listening to increasingly incendiary rhetoric over the past few years, I do, however, remain horrified at the actions of people against our democracy. I am also grieved by the use of traditional Christian symbols and language to call for violence against our government and our country and our leaders. I reclaim the language of the church and state unequivocally that we do not support or encourage the use of the Lord's Prayer or other Christian language to be misappropriated in calls for violence. We are filming this worship service this morning, Wednesday morning, January 13th, 2021. By the time you view it, we may be seen as tone deaf or out of touch with current events. Such is the nature of video church in this time of pandemic. I want to offer these familiar words of Psalm 46. God is our refuge and our strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth should change, though the mountains shake in the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble with its tumult. God is in the midst of the city. It shall not be moved. God will help it when the morning dawns. The nations are in an uproar. The kingdoms totter. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. I encourage you to join our Sunday school class that can be accessed via the Zoom platform. If you need a link to that group, please contact the church or Pastor Eric as he ably teaches that group each Sunday morning. I also remind you that your offerings can be mailed to the church, to the office here, or dropped off during the week. You may also give through our online portal found on the conference website. Our expenses do continue even as our buildings are closed, and we appreciate your financial support as our ministries still need funding. And now, let us pray the prayer for a time of national crisis from our book of worship in the United Methodist Church. God of all the ages, in your sight, nations rise and fall and pass through times of peril. Now, when our land is troubled, be near to judge and to save. May leaders be led by your wisdom. May they search your will and see it clearly. If we have turned from your way, reverse our ways and help us repent. Give us your light and your truth. Let them guide us through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Thank you. As we enter into a time of prayer, I call your attention to the prayer list, which has been emailed to you. There are those in our community who are suffering, who are sick. Some are in and out of the hospital. And so I would just lift those persons to your conscious care. Reach out to those who may need to hear from someone, just an encouraging word. If we were in person, I would ask you to lift your hand if you had a need that you didn't want to even say out loud. And so I ask you in this moment to lift your hands as we go in prayer to our Lord. Gracious and loving God, there are many things on our hearts and in our minds that trouble us. Lord, we give them to you. Lord, there are moments of joy and surprise that we are grateful for this week and even this day. Thank you, God, for being present in our lives. Lord, for those who we know who are sick and suffering, we ask that you be with them, that you breathe into them your breath of sustaining life. And for those we do not know about, we ask also that you open our eyes so that we may be your hands and heart and feet in this world, ministering among your people. Lord, when our hearts are grieved, when our minds are troubled, we come to you, knowing that you are our refuge, you are our strength. We are grateful to you for the harmony you can give to us. And Lord, we ask all of these things this morning in the name of your very precious child, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our scripture reading this morning comes from 1 Samuel, chapter 3, the first 18 verses. Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were not widespread. At that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying down in his room. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called, Samuel! Samuel! And he said, Here I am, and ran to Eli, and said, Here I am, for you called me. But he said, I did not call. Lie down again. So he went and lay down. The Lord called again, Samuel. Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, Here I am, for you called me. But he said, I did not call, my son. Lie down again. Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel again a third time. And he got up and he went to Eli and said, Here I am, for you called me. Then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore Eli said to Samuel, Go, lie down, and if he calls you, you shall say, Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood there, calling as before, Samuel, Samuel. And Samuel said, speak, for your servant is listening. Then the Lord said to Samuel, see, I am about to do something in Israel that will make both ears of anyone who hears it tingle. On that day, I will fulfill against Eli all that I have spoken concerning his house from beginning to end. For I have told him that I am about to punish his house forever for the iniquity that he knew because his sons were blaspheming God and he did not restrain them. Therefore, I swear to the house of Eli that the iniquity of Eli's house shall not be expiated by sacrifice or offering forever. Samuel lay there until morning. Then he opened the doors of the house of the Lord. Samuel was afraid to tell the vision to Eli. But Eli called to Samuel and said, Samuel, my son. He said, here I am. Eli said, what was it that he told you? Do not hide it from me. May God do so to you and more also if you hide anything from me of all that he told you. So Samuel told him everything and hid nothing from him. And then he said, it is the Lord. Let him do what seems good to him. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. O Lord, bless the hearing, the understanding, and the proclamation of your word. Amen. The story of Samuel's call is very familiar to most of us. It is included in most children's Bibles and Sunday school materials because it involves a child. And those of us who have grown up in the church have heard it told many times. If you didn't grow up in the church, it might be a new story to you. There is Samuel, having been left at the temple in the care of Eli, the priest. Basically, his mother took him to church when he was very young and left him with the minister. And now the little boy Samuel is hearing a voice. Three times he hears his name being called, and of course he thinks it's Eli calling. But instead, Eli helps him figure out that it is actually God who is calling Samuel. And God tells Samuel many things that are to happen to his friend Eli and to his country Israel. There's some comedian who says, when people talk to God, we call it prayer. When God talks back, we call it delusion. What do you think? Do you think God still talks to us today? Have you heard the voice of God lately? And if you admitted to hearing the voice of God, would somebody tell you you were crazy? Would you personally think you might have gone a little nuts? Samuel hears an ordinary voice, the voice of someone he knew well and trusted deeply. Samuel thinks it is Eli calling him. Sometimes God uses those we know and trust to speak to us. We may not realize that it is God who's calling us at first either. It takes God calling two or three times before Eli realizes that God is the one calling Samuel. See? Sometimes we don't even hear God when we're called. We need others to help us out, to interpret for us. That is why we have a church community. We in the church must be willing to assist each other in discerning our callings. Samuel thought that God spoke through the adult prophet of Eli. He learned that God could also speak directly to him, and that would impact the rest of his life. Imagine at a young age, while still in grade school, you heard the powerful voice of God. You'd just grow up thinking, well, of course, God could speak to me. And this story shows us that God does not need intermediaries. God can speak directly to any of us. Each of us is called. We all have a purpose and a mission and a job to do for our God. And that call may be directly to us, or it may be through someone else's voice. Our calling may not be super dramatic like Paul's was in the New Testament on the road to Damascus. It may not even have long-reaching effects like John the Baptist's did. But make no mistake, we are each called. And God often uses ordinary situations to show us that we are called. God spoke to Samuel, and I believe that God still speaks to us. God still moves in this world today. God still calls each of us even now. Many of our mothers shared this wisdom with us as we were growing up. They told us that God gave us two ears and one mouth so that we would listen twice as much as we would talk. We need to learn to listen to God, but also be open to listening for God. But where can we turn in order to hear God's voice? Are there any judges or prophets like Eli and Samuel today? Are our prophets the ministers on television? Are our denominational leaders prophets? How does God speak today? What does God's voice sound like? I think we would all agree that in one way or another, we must discern God's voice for our own lives. Jesus compares himself to a shepherd in John 10, verse 4, when he says, "The good shepherd goes ahead of them, and his sheep follow them because they know his voice." And we must remember that God might not necessarily speak to us through evangelism on TV or popular pastors or authors of today. We might get a word from the Adam Hamiltons or the Mike Slaughters or the Joel Osteens, but we might also receive a word through the least expected ways, like a young boy who was unprepared and not expecting a divine voice and call. Maybe God speaks to us in the unexpected, like through our pain and our turmoil, not necessarily always in the beautiful orange and yellow glow of a sunset. After all, God's supreme word to us was in a little baby born of parents who were teenagers and peasants and put their baby in a manger. So how do we perceive God's voice? Does God speak to us in an audible way like he did to Samuel? I believe that God speaks in many ways, and sometimes it is through an ordinary event or another regular person. And when you are spoken to, God makes sure that you eventually understand it and that you know God wants you to do something. I also believe that we can relate to experiencing God's voice because we've heard God's voice at certain points in our lives, but some of us just wouldn't put it in the terms of God spoke to me and said, or the Lord told me such and such. More often, we're a lot like little Samuel. We're not sure that it's God's voice we're hearing. I sometimes notice God's voice after the fact, like when I look back on a certain situation and I suddenly discover God was in it. God did speak to me and guide me through it. Kind of like the two disciples on their way to Emmaus, they walk with this stranger that they meet on the road, and it's only after the stranger is gone that they realize it was the Lord Jesus. And they said, "Were not our hearts burning within us when he spoke to us?" But sometimes God communicates with us in a more direct manner. The Bible calls those times manifestations of spiritual gifts. In 1 Corinthians 12, In verse 7, we read, "To each one the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good. To one there is given through the Spirit a message of wisdom. To another a word of knowledge. To another faith. To another by the same Spirit the gift of healing. To another prophecy," and so on. Note that it says, "To each one of us is given." And that includes you and me. And perhaps the reason why some of us don't seem to hear God's voice or don't hear God's voice more often is because we're expecting God to talk to us in this supernatural way, accompanied by flashes in the sky or roaring thunders or a really loud audible voice. And through the story of Samuel, we learn there is something about the way God speaks to us that is very ordinary and very human. After all, remember, Samuel mistook Eli's voice, a very human voice, for God's. Took God's voice for Eli's. So what is God saying to you today? God could be saying something to you right now in the very place where you are. God could be using ordinary people with regular old human voices to speak to you. Is God calling you to teach something to somebody? Is God calling you to a new way of running your business? Is God calling you to marriage or to parenthood? Is God calling you to heal old wounds? Is God calling you to be a prophetic witness to our community? Perhaps you have a special gift. Maybe God has given you a talent or a certain ability. Whatever it is that God has given you, God wants you to use it. Whatever it is that God is saying to you, you are to follow. God calls us to particular times and places with specific purposes in mind as well. I honestly never dreamed I would wind up on the school board. I had applied for the open seat because I was actually encouraging about 50 other people to do it, and several of them said to me, "Well, why don't you apply?" And when I got the call that my name was going to be put forth for a vote, I called my district superintendent. And he said, "Amelia, remember Esther. For such a time as this, you have been called." And I went and I wound up being a peacemaker on that body. I believe that I fulfilled a specific purpose on that entity and in that role, and I believe I was called to do it. Christianity works best when we answer the various calls that God places on our lives, when we're listening to and responding to God, even in our world today. This might sound a little confusing at first, but I think one of the worst things that ever happened to Christianity was when Constantine legalized it. Constantine, if you remember, was emperor in about 400 AD. His mother, Helen, was amazing and gets credited for the deification of many of the religious sites in the Holy Land because it was a campaign of hers to find them and mark them as shrines for pilgrims. But as emperor, Constantine took away the persecutions of the Christians and made Christianity a state religion, which was good in that it eliminated persecutions. But then everyone had to be a Christian. God really needs to be chosen by us and accepted by us. God really doesn't force a relationship with us. God only calls us, and it's up to us to answer and follow. You must choose. You must accept. And we choose today as well. The world is full of difficult choices, very powerful temptations. And sure, that can be confusing. It can be very difficult. But it's a good thing in that now we have to be intentional about following Christ. You have to really mean it. You aren't just a Christian because you were born in a particular country, like if you were born in the Roman Empire under Constantine. You have to go out of your way to be a Christian, and we must follow whatever God is calling and saying to us. The psalmist says, O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it completely. For it was you who knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am wonderfully made. The Lord knows us and has wonderfully made us and calls us. And we must be honest with ourselves about what we are being called to do. We are called to be the church. We are called to stand against injustice. We are called to stand against that which is evil in our world. But just like with Samuel, there is something very ordinary about how God can speak to us. So the next time you are sensing this urge to give someone a call, call that person, because it may be God's way of telling you this person really needs to talk to someone. And if suddenly, out of the blue, this sentence or that this message pops into your head and it doesn't really make sense to you, but it keeps coming back to you, perhaps you're supposed to share that message with someone. Those words may wind up being the word of life to someone who sits near you, who has in your community contact with you, someone who's desperately waiting for an answer from God. Let us become more sensitive to the voice of God within and all around us. Let us listen to the Word of God in the ordinary experiences of our lives. And let us speak in truth those words to one another. Amen. And amen. Beloved, let us go forth in the name of the God who gives us life, the Christ who gives us love, and the Spirit who gives us peace.